What's up, y'all? This is Revolutionary Fitness Radio, Episode 9. Welcome to another episode of Revolutionary Fitness Radio. I'm your host, Sean Garcia, and this is the podcast dedicated to bringing health, fitness, and wellness to the people. Our goal, empowering you all to understand your body, treat it well, and give you the tools to become an agent of change in your community through helping others. Let's move together.
Yo, what you know about the running, the stretching, the carters, the weapons, the path, the journey, the jewels, the learning, the fear, the focus, the aches, the pains, the contact sparring, the breaks, the sprains, the trial and error, the ranks and belts, the spiritual growth, the science of breath, the tests, the techniques, the forms, the stances, the flow, the rhythm, the internal answers, the herbs, the healing, the quiet meditation, the truths revealed through daily dedication, the love for the art, the sweat on your shirt, the mind, the body, and the spirit at work, the feelings of failure, the hopes to succeed, the battles with questions like, should I...
Thanks for checking back in. If you're a new listener, thank you for joining us here on Revolutionary Fitness Radio. Revolutionary Fitness Radio is brought to you by Revolutionary Fitness. You can find us at www.revolutionaryfitness.org. And you can also find us on Facebook at RevFitNYC and also on Twitter, Instagram at the handle RevFitNYC. That's RevFitNYC. And if you're a new listener to the show, then, you know, thanks for joining in. Drop a little review on iTunes or Stitcher or whatever service you're using. And the format of our show is we do mostly interviews, interviewing different people from the health and fitness world who can enlighten our community on different topics around health and fitness, but also expose us to, you know, different types of training, different philosophies, all that good stuff. So hopefully all you listeners can take what you feel is relevant and discard what you think it doesn't jam with, you know, what you believe in. And that's all good. We just hope to provide you with as much info as possible. So we always start off the show, or more recently, actually, we started off the show giving a tip of the week. So it's January 2nd on the airing of this show. So the tip of the week is actually, you know, in relation to New Year's. So with New Year's, people start New Year's resolutions and people want to make some, you know, significant lifestyle changes. Many people, you know, whether it be exercising more, changing up their nutrition, maybe quitting smoking, you know, whatever your goals may be for the new year. Obviously, as a fitness professional, I want to make sure that people are making substantial life changes and not just making a resolution, but actually working on lifestyle changes. But of course, people are more motivated around the new year. And so during this time, our tip of the week is basically to announce your resolutions. So whatever your resolutions may be, and, you know, there may be many of them, they may be big, they may be small, whatever they are, you should announce them. So whether it be on social media, to a friend, a family member, to a group of colleagues, whoever it is, you should announce it. You should make it verbal. You should make a proclamation so that those who, you know, who you're sharing this with can hold you accountable. And you're going to need that support, because whenever you're trying to make a lifestyle change, you're going to run into a lot of hurdles. You're going to run into some self-doubt. You're going to run into some bad habits. And there's no better motivator for us as humans, you know, being such a social creature that we are. There's no better motivator than to have our peers, our colleagues look to us and hold us accountable. So for instance, I personally, on my personal blog, have started publishing my exercise log, my exercise diary. So I log all my workouts on my website and, you know, I share with people what movements I'm doing, how much weight I'm using, all that kind of stuff. And of course, you know, I want to be able to motivate people and give people ideas on different ways to train, but it's also a way to hold myself accountable, because on those days when I'm feeling kind of lazy or I'm exhausted, or it's just a really long day of, you know, giving classes and teaching one-on-one sessions, and, you know, I come up with excuses in my head, I come up with self-doubt about why I shouldn't, you know, oh, I'm too tired today, I shouldn't strain myself, I shouldn't work out. But now that I'm logging these exercises on my website, I'm like, oh, snap, but people are going to see that I haven't worked out for 2 or 3 days, and I got to make sure that I get it in. So it's a motivator for me, and that kind of social motivation and accountability can go a long way. So obviously be selective with who you share it with. You know, you don't want to share all your goals and aspirations with everybody. So be mindful of who you share it with. But that is definitely the tip of the week. Share your resolution, verbalize it, put it on social media, put it on your website, your blog, whatever it is. Share it with the world, okay? So today we're super excited about the guest we have on, a very special guest, one of my very close friends, a mentor in the health and fitness world, someone who from very on in my career, you know, I studied, I you know, looked up to, I reached out to, I went to his courses and tried to get as much knowledge as I could from this guy. And I'm talking about Jon Hinds. Jon Hinds, for those who don't know, Jon Hinds is a sports and a conditioning coach based out of Milwaukee, actually. And Jon Hinds is the founder of Monkey Bar Gyms, Monkey Bar Gymnasium. And we're going to talk a lot about that over the interview. But I wanted to do a little bit of an introduction because I actually pre-recorded the interview. So I'm doing this after the fact. But I wanted to highlight a couple of the things that Jon has done. So Jon is a former NBA strength and conditioning coach for the LA Clippers. And he's also trained individual athletes like Anthony Hardaway, Charles Smith from the Knicks, Lucius Harris from the Nets, Daryl Strawberry from the Yankees, and many, many more. And he's also, trained some celebrities like Demi Moore, Woody Harrelson, a lot of notable folks. And so Jon, back in 2000, he started the Monkey Bar Gym, Monkey Bar Gymnasium. And these were gyms where kind of super revolutionary at the time, really getting away from mainstream gyms and getting rid of mirrors, getting rid of machines, going to a more holistic approach, talking about plant-based nutrition, talking about barefoot training. Before really anyone else was talking about this stuff, Jon and Monkey Bar Gym were doing this back in 2000. Jon is also the VP of Lifeline Products, Lifeline USA Products, which you can find a lot of the cool tools that you find in the gym, like the power wheel, you know, that big black ab wheel, the big one, the one that you can put your feet into. That was founded by Jon and his team over at Lifeline. And of course, so many other products that they've put out. So definitely check out Lifeline online and see. And also, of course, check out monkeybargym.com. But Jon has been a big influence on my training personally, but also on the structure of Revolutionary Fitness. So if you've ever been to one of our classes, you'll feel a big influence from Jon and Monkey Bar Gym. We really look up to those guys, and they've been doing a lot of great work. And we were super excited about booking Jon for this interview. And, you know, hope you guys enjoy it. If you have any feedback, any extra questions that you want for Jon, just hit us up either on our blog, on our website, or through iTunes, through a comment, and we'll definitely get back to you. And maybe, you know, if you have any questions for Jon that he didn't answer on the podcast, shoot us those questions and we'll get them to Jon. And I'm sure he'll be very, very easy to get responses from. So enjoy the episode. Let us know what you think. Thanks.
We aren't caught up in your love affair, and we'll never be royals.
Royals.
It's a run in our blood. That kind of luck just ain't for us. We crave a different kind of buzz. Let me be your ruler.
Ruler.
Alright guys, so we're here with Jon Hinds. For those who don't know who Jon is a strength and conditioning coach based out of Madison, Wisconsin. He's been, you know, training for strength and conditioning for decades now. I've been following Jon for a very long time. He's one of the bigger influences on my fitness career, and definitely in regards to Revolutionary Fitness. He and the brand that he's built with Monkey Bar Gym have been big influences on the work that we do and our style of training. So Jon is on here as New Year's, talking about resolutions or lifestyle changes, and I think Jon has a lot of valuable lessons. So Jon, what's up, man? How you doing?
Hey, Sean, I'm good. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming on, brother. So the first question that we kind of ask everybody is to kind of introduce yourself and talk about how you got into fitness.
It was a long time ago. I got into fitness when I was probably 6, 7 years old. My dad, Bobby Hinds, invented the beaded jump rope. And I started jumping rope and seeing the fitness industry as an industry. That's pretty young. And then I've been in it around it since that time because of my dad. At around 10 he, or 11 or so, he invented using tubing for working out. And both of those things are cool on themselves that he developed them. I mean, tubing and forms of it have been used for a long time. Jump ropes have been used for a long time. But one thing my dad did that was unique back then, and it's still, now it's a mainstay, is having a program with your product. And so I got started with that and started realizing to have a program with it at a very early age. And I just have always stayed involved with it. And I always had a fascination with athletic performance, especially basketball and jump training. And I just continued to try and learn as much as possible and grow into those as much as possible until when I was in college, somebody told me there was a actual profession that's called personal training. And this is back in 1982. I heard about this.
I'm not even going to tell you how old I was in 82, bro.
You weren't probably even born back then, little bastard, but were you even born?
I was in the process. I was in the womb.
Well, I was just being born in the person. I had actually been a strength coach for a couple of years before personal training even started. And when I was in college then, I started personal training people when I was like 18, 19 years old. So that was, that was like 32 years ago. So been doing it ever since. Always been trying to figure out ways to help people train and to myself train more efficiently. And then over the last 15 years or so, I've gotten a lot more into learning how to restore aches and pains, prevent them and restore the body and heal it. And in the form of restoration through Aishu's yoga, and then also through eating plant-based or plant-strong, however you want to put it. But those two components have become a really big part of my life over the last 15 years. And so I try and apply all three and feel like I do a pretty good job of that. And so that's why I share it.
Awesome, awesome. So you, I mean, your career, you've been training for a while and you've worked with a lot of professional athletes, some famous folks, some everyday regular folks. And a little over a decade ago, right, you started Monkey Bar Gym. What was kind of the thought process behind that?
The reason why I started the Monkey Bar Gym in August of 2000 was I ran into a friend of mine that I used to train with for fight training in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. His name is Eric Paulson, and he always admired the way that I trained because I've never been a fan of machines. I've always been a fan of body weight, bands, and just lifting heavy hot things and stuff. And I've always been a fan of that since I was little, and I always got really great results. And Eric told me, when he and I were talking one day, he goes, "Man, you should have a gym that trains like that, because there is none." Mm-hmm. And this is back in 96 around then. And I thought about it, and I started just training people outside on monkey bars when I moved back to Madison. And I got a big following. And then I already had a jiu-jitsu following here in Madison. I had some like 25 some students when I started teaching jiu-jitsu back here. And so I thought, you know what? I think Eric's right. I'm going to open up a place because there is none. Because all I saw was traditional machine-laden fitness facilities and or yoga studios. And there was nothing in between for people. And I thought if I wanted that, I'm sure other people wanted something else. So I opened what I still think is the first no machines, no mirrors, no shoes gym in the United States back in August of 2000. And I just was fortunate to have met people that, like Roger Aishens, had taught me his Aishens yoga, taught me about barefoot training back in 97. and other people. I've just been really fortunate to meet them. So it gave me really good baselines for the mountain bike gym way back then. And it's pretty much stayed the exact same since I opened.
Yeah, that's awesome. You're speaking about the jiu-jitsu. Did you see that the Anderson Silva fight?
That made me sick. That was horrible.
Yeah, that made me nauseous.
So bad for him. What a horrible. I mean, to come back from that will be very hard, and then to have confidence to kick again will be very hard. I don't know if he could ever fight. If he'll ever fight again. And what a tragic way to end a career on.
Yeah.
That just bummed me out. Seeing that, I felt so bad for him. He's such an awesome fighter.
Yeah, definitely greatest of all time.
And even the guy, Chris Wedman, the guy who won, what a way to win. He's a good kid, though, you know. And he gave a lot of respect to him, but Chase even said how unfortunate that was.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, everyone involved, I'm sure, was affected by that. I mean, all of us watching were affected by it. So, all right, so back to Monkey Bar Gym. So, you talked a little bit about your influences with Roger, Aishin, and also you talked about the plant-based nutrition stuff. So can you talk a little bit more about that? Because I think, you know, nowadays we're seeing a little bit more of these smaller box gyms, right? The CrossFit's developing all over the place, and, you know, we have our critiques of those folks. But, you know, I think something that's still truly unique is this whole plant-based approach. So what was the feelings behind that?
Well, there's a couple of reasons behind me going plant-based. 1989, 1990, I was a personal trainer out in L.A., and I was actually Woody Harrelson's trainer from 89 to 97 until I moved back to Madison. Mm. And I tried to get Woody to drink milk and to eat meat, and he was like, "John, I'm a vegan," and he had to explain it to me, And instead of getting him to drink milk, he got me to stop drinking milk for a week. He said, "Just try it for 1 week." And so I did. And by day three, I felt so much cleaner. And I was like, "I'm never going back to drinking milk." And then he explained the whys of it and stuff like that, why you don't want to drink it and stuff like that. And so back then, I stopped cheese, milk, cottage cheese, all of that stuff. And I had always felt better because of that single move. But then soon as I opened my Monkey Bar gym, I was competing in Latin Jiu-Jitsu, and I started to develop a really bad hand pain, both hands. And so, where the heck was I? Oh, yeah, I developed a hand pain, and I was at a loss to how to fix it. I went to a bunch of doctors. They said you could get surgeries. And I completely disagreed with that. And a guy named John Allen Mollenhauer called me up out of the blue to talk to me about one of my inventions, the power wheel. And we got to aches and pains. We got just to talking about aches and pains in the body. And I said, "Yeah, I got some in my hands." And he said, "How long you had it?" And I said, "About 3 or 4 years. And it's getting worse." And told him my story, and he said, "Well, you want me to help you fix it?" I said, "Hell yeah. I mean, I've tried everything else. I've been to like 4 doctors, and they all said, "Well, we can do surgery." Or they said, "Well, you're coming up for 40 years old, John. You have arthritis. You just got to accept it." And I was like, "Man, screw that." Accepting of something like that to me just didn't resonate at all. I just felt like this, something's not right here. If that's my only choice, and it's not, and that's the truth. As soon as John talked to me about it, he sent me a pre-release version of the China study, and it didn't come out for another year and a half, but he was kind enough, because he worked on it with Dr. Colin Campbell, he sent me a pre-release version of it and underlined all the points that I really needed to read right away, and they said a diet of over 10% animal products will can definitely lead to arthritis. And my diet was heavily laden in animal products still, not milk, but I still took whey protein powder, like in my oatmeal or in my smoothies. So I still ate chicken, I still ate meat, and I still ate like salmon and fish and stuff like that, and lots of eggs. And I thought I had to, you know, in order to maintain my muscle mass. And so John said, no, you don't. And in fact, it's going to get rid of your hand pain if you switch. I did. About 6 weeks later, my hand pain was completely gone, and I've never had hand pain since. And that was a huge change in my life. And since that time, I've really learned how to hone in to not just prevent and reverse aches and pains in the body caused by poor nutrition, but I've learned how to add muscle to a body, no matter what age you're at, through plant-based nutrition. And that's the thing that scares away most people, because they think you can't do it, but you totally can.
That's awesome. So why do you think it's something that you should be implementing with folks who become members of your gyms?
Because of a couple of reasons. It's best for the planet. The production of animal products is the number two reason for global warming, the transportation of them and the production of them. The damage that it does to animals, the terrifying circumstances of which animal factories are in place is horrible, and animals are killed in a horrible manner. Also, I just love animals anyway, so I don't want to kill animals if I don't have to. And if a person can get as healthy or healthier and not kill animals and not do the planet harm, then why the hell wouldn't we do that? Mm-hmm. And so it's been proven in the CITES study, it's the healthiest way for people and planet to eat. And so because of that, and the fact that I know how to teach people in a manner that can build lean muscle mass and increase their health and performance, why the hell wouldn't we do that? It's the easiest thing that we can do to help the planet and ourselves.
Yeah, definitely. So what do you, I haven't heard you speak about it, but what's your thoughts on the whole paleo craze?
It's another craze. And I think it's complete BS, because the facts that they're saying is that it's hereditary for us is completely bogus. We are not predators. Don't have fangs. We don't have claws. We don't have a digestive tract that's proper for meat. We don't have the enzymes and the chemical breakdown of our mouths even to break down meats and other animal products efficiently. Now, we can eat them, but it doesn't mean it goes through our digestive tract as easily as plants do. That's just one point. The other point is that because we're not predators, I think back in the day we ate meat because we were scavengers, because we were out on the plains and we had to just, and we saw animals killing, eating meat, and if you're not in a gathering type of society, you see other animals eating meat, why wouldn't you do the same? Mm. You know, and you see some animals eating leaves and stuff like that, why wouldn't you do the same? So you're going to do the same. And that's why I think we are just scavengers. And they base their entire argument on the fact that it's in our DNA to eat meat, kill and eat meat, but it's not. At no point in my life or anybody else's life do you literally feel like attacking and killing a rabbit with your bare teeth and hands. It's completely illogical. Mm.
It'd be interesting to see, too, any case studies in 30 years. I mean, because there hasn't been, right? Any case studies of folks who've been on paleo for 30 years, what kind of things it does to the body.
Exactly. You're right. And like all of those diets, like if you go to a hardcore, remember even Atkins, mm-hmm. that stuff helps people get leaner. And a typical bodybuilder diet, which the paleo basically is, it's eat greens, eat meat, have fats in it. That's how a person gets lean. And that's a proven bodybuilder's diet for, geez, a long time, mm-hmm. You know? But their whole premise of that it's in our DNA, I think, is just ridiculous. But what I like to stress is our main thing being here on this planet is to help each other. It's to serve. It's to help one another, right? Mm. So then why wouldn't we do something that helps one another and eat more plants and eat less meat, because that is the single easiest thing for us to do to reduce global warming.
That's a great point. And
that's one point that I look at a person who eats paleo, and you know, if it works for them, if it makes them happy, you know, and they're doing it like farm raised and grass fed or whatever and stuff like that. Yeah, I understand that, but the fact remains they're still eating a lot of animal products, and that still is production of animal products, which does the planet a greater bad, basically. And it's so much easier, I think, to eat locally, eat whatever it is, but that still does the planet a lot better if we eat more greens. That's just not how I feel about it. I don't like to, you know, the one thing about it, though, that I don't like to do is I don't want to say, you're wrong, I'm right. It's eating is such a individual thing, and it's really a touchy subject for people. And so one of the things that I even do, and I've even talked to paleo people about this, is that eating paleo, you know, you can eat a ton of vegetables, and they eat, I just feel too much animal products. But if they were to, if a person that way, if they just toned it down just a little bit and ate more greens, and they still could get a huge impact on the planet, they still would reduce the killing and slaughtering and horrible conditions for a lot of animals. That to me is what I strive to get people to just reduce it. You know, I'm not saying you got to go 100% raw vegan or anything like that. I just try to get people to go more towards eating plants and less towards eating animal products and find their path that suits them. Because one proven fact is if I said, Sean, you got to eat this way, most likely you might eat that way for a while, but then you're probably going to go back to your old way. And that's a proven fact. And that's one of the unhealthiest things that we can do. So what I try and strive for is I try and get people to eat plant-based, which is about 90% or more plants. But if it's 80% and that person's coming from eating a diet that's 60% plants and they're moving towards 70-30 maybe, hey, that's improvement, and they're on a pathway that is something that they can maintain for a long time, that's a lot healthier for them. Yeah. And they're much less likely to go back to their old way of eating, which was more animal products. So I just try and get people to going more plants and less animals. And I think that's a more realistic way to do it.
Definitely, definitely. So you talked about Raja Aishin, and you talked about Aishin's yoga and restoration. I remember being at one of your workshops a couple years back, and you saying something about, you know, a trainer has to know how to hurt, and when we mean hurt, we mean like a good hurt, like, you know, make you burn. But you also have to know how to heal. And I remember being a young trainer and thinking, wow, you know, like, I've never heard that before, because typically we think of, when we think of getting in shape, you know, losing weight, we think, you know, beat ourselves down, you know, beat ourselves to the ground 6-7 days a week, every opportunity we get, work out. So what do you mean by this restoration and healing?
The way to become truly healthy, I feel, is you train and you restore. You have a balanced body. And one of the things that happens is that because of the fact that we wear shoes that have too much support, because of the fact that we sit in chairs all day, we have lack of confidence, and, you know, maybe we slouch or we lift our ribs or whatever it is, we, as we get older, get in worse and worse alignment. So even if you're just doing fitness training, you will, because of the fact that you're getting more and more out of alignment, you will naturally compensate to do whatever movement you are asked to do. And the more that we compensate, the more likelihood we have of aches and pains or injury to occur. And so one of the things that I learned from Raj a long time ago was we can reverse misalignments in the body by actively engaging weakened links in the body. And that restores health because you're putting it in, you're stacking the body how it is supposed to be, and that performs more efficiently, reverses injury, and creates a body that feels light rather than heavy. And what I see out there is the mindset of trainers, and I was this way as well, is that train, 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 and the alternative is maybe do some type of static stretching or do some type of yoga, maybe if you're in a very small percentage, but generally train to create the balances. Because a lot, like way back in the day, people used to do rear delt flies because everybody got so internally rotated from doing bench press and pull downs. Mm. They do rear delt flies to try and balance the body out. But what they do is they compensate and they miss the smaller muscles that really set the alignment properly. And because of that, you won't address those weak links in the body. And so what I said to you a long time ago was, we want to have the ability to hurt them, crush them in a workout. You want to have the ability to take it to whatever intensity that you want with your client or your class, if you're a trainer. But you also, and saying that in a completely positive way, not of hurting anybody, but you also want to have the ability to heal somebody and create more balance in the body. And I think, from where I stand, I'd say less than 1% of trainers out there that know how to do that.
Yeah.
And that's sort of scary because that's pushing people down a road of a lot of compensation and a lot of likelihood of injuries to come. And for me as a trainer of many years, it's simple to learn how to do things that can reverse those pains in the body. And as a trainer, it behooves you to do those things with your client, and whether it's an individual or in a class.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, I run into it every day. We talk about, in the gyms and the big box gyms and things like CrossFit, you see the constant beatdown and the healing being something of some kind of supplementary value, you know, something like, oh, do this here and there when you can, blah, blah, blah. And even when I talk to some of my clients or some of my class members, I tell them, you know, anytime I'm giving them advice on restoration, they're looking at me like I'm silly. Like, why am I going to waste time doing that? And, you know, why, you know, let's get to the real work. And it takes a lot to kind of break that mindset and get people to focus on restoring the body and the importance of it.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. But as a good trainer, you explain to them, you know, look, we can. The simplest thing I always say is, would you drive a car if you have a wheel out of alignment? Mm. And then they go, no. And so why do you train your body at a high level? Why do you want to try and train at a high level when your wheels are out of alignment? Mm. That's a real simple thing, and nobody is going to deny that fact, especially when you point it out. Okay, do a squat. See how your knee's collapsing? See how your foot's collapsing? Those are wheels out of alignment. Now, if you run or jump, sure, you can do those things, but you're asking for trouble. Mm. You know, I can race a car with the wheel out of alignment, but I'm asking for trouble because it might go out on me. Mm. That's the exact same thing with clients or people in your classes. You know, because everybody wants to go hard. Like, you know, CrossFit's really known for that. They like to push people really hard. And that's really popular today to do really intensive workouts because they're cool. Like doing plyos, perfect example. 95% of people shouldn't do plyos because they're not prepared for them and they're out of alignment. But yet people do them because they get your heart rate up so high and because they're fun. Mm-hmm. They look cool. But they cause a lot of injuries because people don't know how to do them, and they adapt, and they get they can't adapt well enough, and they tweak themselves.
Yep, yep. All right, cool. So we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about some tips for the new year and get things started off right.
Don't sweat the technique. Don't sweat the technique. And check the file. Let's see who bit the dot, tech the style. I flip the script so it can't get filed. At least not now.
now, it'll take a while. I change the pace to complete the beat. I drop the bass to MCs get weak. For every road they trace is a scar they keep. It's when I speak, they freak to sweat the technique. I made my debut in 86 with a melody and a president's mix. And now I stay on target and refuse to miss. And I still make hits for beats, parties, clubs, and cars and jeeps. My underground sound vibrates the streets. MCs wanna beef, then I play for keeps. When they sweat the technique. Don't sweat the technique. Know how many bombs have I ripped and wrecked, but researchers never found all the pieces yet. Scientists try to solve the context, philosophers are wondering what's next. Pieces took the lab to observe them, they couldn't absorb them, they didn't deserve them. My ideas are only for the audience ears, my opponents it might take years. Pencils, pens, and swords, letters put together from a key to cause. I'm also a sculpture, born with structure, because of my culture I'm a perfect instructor. Style that'll be full of technology, complete sights and new heights after I get deep. You don't have to speak, just see and peep the technique. But don't sweat the technique. I speak in the squeak. Then I get deep and the beat then complete. Pulled with the scene, never weak or obsolete. They never grow old, techniques become antiques. Better than something brand new, cause it's original. In a wild style I have much more volume. Classical, too intelligent to be radical. Masterful, never irrelevant, mathematical. Here's some soothing souvenirs for all the years. And for the sort of thoughts and ideas. It's cool when you freak to the beat, but don't sweat the technique. Don't sweat the technique. Don't sweat the technique.
All right, guys, so we're back here with Jon Hinds. Jon has been breaking down a lot of his training philosophies, some of the foundational stuff of Monkey Bar Gym. Before we move on to the next topic, I wanted to ask you really quick about your symbol, because it resonates with me. You know, even before I even knew what it was, it was just something about the image that resonated with me. Can you talk about what the image represents and what the motivation was behind it?
Sure. When I was in Los Angeles as a trainer, I one day I was training Steven Gutenberg, and I just looked at him and I said, I don't want to do this anymore. The facade of the fitness industry made me sick, where it made me just feel like the whole thing is about appearance and not performance. I trained all my clients as functionally as I could. I always have. But looking in a gym and seeing everybody so focused on appearance, it made me sick. It was so much about themselves, their egos. And so one day out there, I said, I quit. I'm done. I'm out of the fitness industry. I can't stand it. And that was in July 97. And I said, I'm going to go invent some products like my power wheel and stuff like that. So I moved back to Madison. And like I was telling you earlier, I started getting a following of people training with me on playground equipment, the monkey bars. And at that same time, though, I was learning from Roger Isons how to heal the body. My entire learning lesson from Roger Isons was about positive benefits of people helping people, giving feedback. And that's what his whole Isons yoga is all about. So I thought, why can't we do that with fitness training as well? Because it is massively needed in the fitness world, because the reason why I couldn't stand being in the fitness world is because of how ego-driven it was. It's purely about appearance. And growing up, playing on the playground, it was never about appearance. It was about having fun. And I was like, why can't we get back to that? Why can't we get back to where you want to go and move and do things like you did on the playground when you were a kid? And that, to me, was really sad. And I thought, well, what a great way this is with the Aichin's Yoga Partner Feedback, applying it to traditional exercise movements that are really fun to do anyways. We empower people to help one another, which is what I talked about before anyways with the nutrition. It's in our gut to want to help others. And so if we can do it on the nutrition, that's awesome. But then the main thing that I opened the gym about was because we can do it with training. I can help you and you can help me. And if you learn the basics of Aichin's Yoga, you can really help, you know, each other by correcting alignments so that they don't go down a path of a lot of compensation, developing aches and pain, but they go down the path of building even a stronger foundation of alignment, preventing injuries or reversing them and performing at high levels. And those are the physical attributes, but the mental ones of helping another person are huge. And so the logos represent that. Once I had gotten that type of training and I had blended it with my exercises, then I said, I want a logo that represents people helping people. And my dad used to be an art teacher, and he's an artist. And so I asked him if he wouldn't mind designing some logos that would represent people helping people, full body movement, and balance. And in about 10 minutes, he had 15 of the coolest logos you've ever seen. And that was literally an extremely hard choice for me to pick that one. But that's the one I finally came up with. And I get compliments all the time on the logo. And my dad made it for me in about just a few seconds. So it's a cool story behind it. The logo means a lot. And it means a lot for people and planet. Balance and helping one another.
Yeah, and I mean, I could definitely testify to the fact that it is just not something, you're not just saying it to say like, oh, we're about building community and all that jazz. I mean, the first time I encountered you guys, the feeling of community was immediate, you know, the feeling of kind of belonging and being supported and working with each other through our strengths and our weaknesses and all that good stuff. And I mean, ever since, you know, you've always been super receptive and helpful to me and always easy to reach out to, you know, who was I? So nobody out of New York City just reaching out to Jon Hinds, and you were always really down and really supportive of all the stuff that we were doing with our work. So definitely that sense of building community is strong and is a great thing that you guys are doing.
Good to hear that it's working.
Yes, sir. So go for it.
No, go ahead.
So I was going to say, so going into the new year, let's talk a little bit about, you know, building oneself up, building one's community. What do you think are some of the biggest hurdles that people are running into with these New Year's resolutions or trying to make some change in the new year?
Trying to make too big of a change and not having their own way. That to me is it's got to come from within you, and it's got to be enjoyable. And I think people make too big a change on things instead of finding what they can do for the long term. Like one thing I always tell people, cut out milk, cut out cow's milk, make that one change. That's a great place to start. And then also make sure that you try whatever exercises you're doing, work to improve upon them. But in that process, have a lot of fun with it. You know, and don't look at it like 60 days and 90 days of where you're going to make change, but like look at it like where you find a way that you enjoy it so that you can do it on a day-to-day basis. That's what's going to last for a long time, and that's where you're going to get those results that don't rebound in a negative way towards you later on, but you're going to get nice, consistent results, and they'll be easy to maintain and improve upon. Yeah, that's what I see.
I mean, we could have picked a lot of people to have been on this show for New Year's, but, you know, you're a person who I definitely, you know, feel like is always growing. I mean, how old are you now?
I'm 50.
50. So, I mean, you're definitely stronger than me and you're stronger than a lot of my peers. And I think every year, you set some personal goals to be stronger and stronger, right? Getting out of those taboos of becoming weaker and weaker as you get older. So can you talk about kind of what your strategies are, maybe what you did in 2013 and some goals you may have had physically and or, you know, even in your life and how you were able to achieve some of those?
Sure. Like you said, it's important that you find goals. And I always try and find something that inspires me. Many years ago, like I ran the guys online, my boy Zeph from the Barbarians and stuff, he inspired the hell out of me to try different types of body weight exercises. I've been doing body weight my whole life, but they showed me different things. So I really like to get better at those. Mike Mahler, a long time ago, he inspired me to get into kettlebells. And so I didn't want to just do okay at them. I always set myself, like, what are some of the higher numbers for somebody, what they're using? Mm. So what I always try and do is I always try and beat my personal best, and I always keep track of my workouts, and I challenge myself that way. And to me, it's really fun. I really, really enjoy training and trying to beat my PRs on stuff, and no matter what age. And the funny thing is, this year, in the last month, I've broken like 10 personal records that I haven't touched in like 8 years. Mm. And it's just really exciting for me to do that. And whatever it is, if it's kettlebells, if it's Olympic lifting, if it's body weight, if it's push-ups, if it's handstands, if it's handstand walking, if it's trying to do pistols, if it's running, if it's doing parkour or free running, whatever it is, you got to find out what excites you about it in a way that you can work to evolve whatever that is, because that's what continually grows our minds and our bodies. And once we stagnate our minds or our bodies, that's where I feel that we start going in the opposite direction. Instead of growing and becoming healthier, we get sicker and weaker. And that's where I think it's something that people begin to accept as soon as they get out of college, almost, that they're aging, they're getting older, you know, and things like that, and it's inevitable. But I think if you really, really are excited by learning something that stimulates our minds and our bodies and evolving it to a higher and higher level, man, there's no age limit for that. You can do anything and you can have a blast at it.
Yeah, that's awesome. I mean, you definitely, as you say, walk the walk. I mean, just the documentation of your training is always great and helpful and inspiring, and it kind of squashes excuses from a lot of folks.
It's inspiring. Yeah. That's why I post them. I try and, you know, inspire people and show that there is no age limit. And I'm glad you feel like that. I'd like to hear that if it helps other people.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. I mean, if I see a 50-year-old guy doing all these moves, I'm like, all right, I gotta bust this guy's ass in a couple years. Let me catch up to John.
Well, I want to see. I always like, here's one of my favorite quotes. When somebody that, and I love to be able to say this, and I love for other people to be able to say this, that I know or friends with or train, is when somebody comes up to them that's like 25, and they're like, man, I want to be in your shape when I'm your age. And I heard my friend say this back to him. He's 51. He trains at my gym. He goes, you're not even in my shape now, so what are you talking about?
Right on.
I love that, though, and it's so true. I don't want to compare myself to 50-year-olds. I like comparing myself to you and Zeph and Mike Mahler and how can I want to, most I guess I always compare myself to myself. I like getting inspiration. Like if I see you doing something cool, like hand balancing, great. If I see Mike Mahler do something cool, great. That's all that Zeph, my boy, says, mirror inspiration. Because hopefully I inspire you, and you in mirror inspire me in a different way. And he does that with me all the time. And Mike does it with kettlebells, you know, and so that's what's exciting, and that has no age limit, and it's just fun to try and always improve on that. That's what I always try to do.
For sure, for sure. So do you guys have a specific strategy at your gym for the new year? I know you guys do these 60-day challenges and stuff like that. Do you guys have something coming up for 2014?
We have a 60-day challenge starting on January 11th here in Madison. And most of the other Monkey Bar gyms, the 60-day challenge will be starting on January 11th as well. Some of them might have slightly different dates due to their work schedules, but generally that's when we do that. But here in Madison at the one Monkey Bar gym that I own, yeah, that will be January 11th. And those are a great time. We spend a lot of time on teaching people how to eat plant-based, how to train Monkey Bar gym way, and how to restore your body to heal the aches and pains. And with a lot of education in the process of that 60 days. And it turns out great. We get amazing results and improvement of performances. We put on a lot of muscle, but lose a lot of body fat, and people are enjoying eating the way they're doing, and it becomes a way of life instead of a 30 or 60 day change. And so we love it. I've been doing it for about 10, 11 years at my Monkey Bar gyms.
Yeah, yeah. A couple of us in New York actually participated from afar last year, last spring, and I remember... You know, you see the workouts online and you're thinking, oh, okay, this is okay. And then as the weeks progress, you're like, wow, this is tough stuff. And I mean, almost 100% was either body weight or some kind of tubing or something like that. And I was just thinking to myself, like, I'm probably getting stronger than I ever have doing anything with, yeah, I mean, I love barbells and kettlebells, but the strength within and the body weight training is where it's at for sure. Do you, for folks who aren't, you know, near Monkey Bar Gym, or do you guys have options for folks that aren't near Monkey Bar Gym?
Yeah. Well, yeah, we're getting a brand new website, but on our current website, we have alternatives, and we call them travel alternatives. So, perfect example, if a workout calls for cleans and presses with kettlebells, well, then instead, if you're traveling, you can do cable cleans with a TNT cable, and you can make that pretty heavy. And you can do presses of all types of body weight, push-ups, tiger push-ups, handstand push-ups, all types of presses can work like that. So we have an alternative travel page. And so whatever exercise it is, there's an alternative for you on that page.
Mm, awesome. And for those who are familiar maybe with like CrossFit, you know, and their workouts of the day, the WODs, how do you guys differ from that stuff?
The difference between us and CrossFit, I hear that a lot. The biggest thing is the restoration. We integrate it into every workout. We always have. We have three different levels of training. That's a big difference as well. So that no matter what person you are, you have a place to start and a goal level to go towards. And I think that's just a really, really important thing for people so that we properly challenge everybody and we don't injure people. And we have a really, really great record of very rarely having any injury occur at the gym, and then even better of being able to reverse those injuries and or aches and pains in the body. And that's due to having the three levels and integrating all our movements with Aichi Yoga. And those two points are hugely different. The intensity, the intensity is there. That's very similar. We do what's called an undulating periodization program, and I've done that for a long time, and that throws different components of strength, stamina, speed, power, and then we also mix in a metabolic type of workout a couple times a week. What that does, that causes the body to adapt to all different modalities of training so that you get the person who can adapt to everything. And that is the goal in life, I think, is to have the ability to do everything that is thrown at you. So if the situation occurs where you got to pick somebody up, put them on your back and carry them, you can do it. You got to run miles, you can do it. You got to be able to heal the pain and your back pain in your body, you can do it. You know, and that's what we strive to do, and we achieve it with really high levels. And that, I would say that's a huge difference. in between the two of us.
Yeah, I mean, there's a bunch more, but yeah, people got to do some more research for sure. They'll figure it out quick. You know, one of the things that stand out about you is that you're a very emotional dude. You're a very spiritual dude.
What are you talking about?
You know what I mean. You make deep connections, brother. What do you think? Where do you think love and compassion? Where do they play a role in oneself?
Oh man, great question. I do this because I love people. I've always said since I was a little boy, I would do this for free as long as I had food on my table and a roof over my head. And I've told my athletes and everybody always, because it's just something in my heart. I love helping people. And for any trainers out there, that's why we do it. I hope, you know, why everybody does it. But I actually have a real quick little story that I learned from a student of mine. His name was Josh. If it's okay to tell a real quick story.
Yeah, of course. Go for it.
He's a Buddhist guy, and I was training him. He's one of the most calm, quiet, peaceful, loving people I've ever met in my life. And at the time, I was teaching Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for a long time, and I had one of my students was going to fight in his first professional fight up in Minneapolis at the Target Center. So all of us were getting the cars, getting ready to drive up there. And I just had finished training Josh before I was about to leave. He's like, where are you guys going? Oh, we're going to see Carlos fight. He's got his first professional fight tonight. Really? Can I watch? Yeah, you can watch. And I'm sitting there thinking, this is a bad idea. Like, it's going to be sort of bloody and there's going to be broken bones most likely. He goes, that's okay. I'm like, all right, that's cool. So we go up there. Carlos wins. He breaks the guy's arm real bad in like 27 seconds. There's a bunch of really nasty fights this night. Broken bones, a lot of blood and things like that. And I go up to him afterwards and I said, so what'd you think? And I'm fully expecting him to be horrified. And he goes, well, I have to say without a doubt, it was one of the most incredible displays of love I've ever seen in my life. And I looked at him, and at the time I didn't understand it, but I looked at him and I was like, oh, I don't get that at all. You have to explain that to me. And he goes, John, why do you train me so hard? And I was like, because I know I can get a lot out of you. I know I want to help you reach your best. He goes, well, why do you do that? I said, because I love you. And he goes, right. Why do you push me so hard? Because you're giving me love. And he said, why do after you're done fighting, would you hug the guy that you just fought? And some guys, they kissed on the cheek. And I used to do that in jiu-jitsu when we train in Brazil. It's common. You fight somebody, afterwards you give them a kiss on the cheek when you're hugging them. And that's the show of respect, and that's the giving of love back to them for taking you to the very edge of what you can offer. And that's love. And that, to me, is something that is so amazing, but it's so sad that people don't, we don't, just the way that we grow up, a lot of people are held back. And so with our logo, with partners, with the big stressing of people helping people and working with another partner at our gym, what I feel that we are doing on a daily basis is I'm teaching you how to give love to another person through training, through ice and yoga feedback. And then we're also teaching you how to give love to yourself and the planet through eating a plant-based nutrition plan. And to me, that's when I think about what can I do on this planet while I'm here. I want to help people on the planet as much as possible. And I look at it, the way that we train, the way that we restore, and the way that we eat, all give love to ourselves, the people, and planet. And that, to me, is amazing. And that makes me really happy, the fact that we can do that.
Yeah, it's awesome, man. I mean, I think anyone who's ever participated in martial arts and knows anything about it can relate to that, you know, sense of humility and love and connection you feel with somebody when you're in, you know, in the pits with them and stuff. But I think you get the similar feeling when you're working in the gym, and that's kind of fostered, and you're working in a group setting and, you know, doing the format that you guys do. You build that community and that support and all that good stuff, and there's a great display of love for sure. So what do you guys, you guys have obviously your gyms, but you also have your CNT course. Can you talk a little bit about your CNT course? Because I think people would be really interested in that.
Sure. CNT course is something that I developed about 11 years ago. And it was, I developed it because at the time, and there still isn't any course, it teaches people how to heal the body, blend those type of movements in with full body movements. And so I had to have trainers at some point come in and teach for me because I was teaching 44 classes a week and I was getting burned out really bad. So one of my students actually said, "Don, you have to have a course for us." And I was like, "Oh, gosh, yeah, I guess I do." And so I developed my certified natural trainer course, CNT. And this course teaches how to align the body most efficiently to strengthen those weak links of the body, but then how to keep it aligned while you go through movements, whether it's push-ups, pull-ups, squats, hip extensions, running, jumping, whatever it may be. We teach you how to do that. We teach you how to do the Aichi Yoga and restoration therapy. And then we also teach you how to do the learn the basics of eating plant-based so that you can start yourself off on all three of these components and make positive change in your life and the lives around you. And that's the whole goal. I mean, that's what we were talking about before. How great is it to have the ability to help people and planet?
Yeah.
This is what I feel this course provides for a lot of people that may not know how to do it, especially in the fitness world, because it's about ego. It's about separating yourself, basically. And so what a great way that we can help ourselves and other people at the same time and the planet. And that's what the CNT course is about.
Yeah. And you also, I mean, you guys have a fully interactive online version of the CNT course, which makes it really accessible to people around the world.
Right. Anybody can take this course online. It's on our monkeybargym.com website. And it's a CNT level one course. This gives you all the prerequisites for our actual live course, which we'll have one in April and we'll have one in August here in Madison, Wisconsin. And this course is done by you take the course online and then you will submit your videos for us to watch and give you feedback on all three elements of. And then once you pass that, then you can take the level two course. And the level two course is the one that all of our Monkey Bar Gym trainers have to have in order to teach.
Yeah, it's awesome. It's awesome. So, you know, I think we're already past the time, John, but I want to take a personal time to thank you, obviously, for all the influence you've had on my career and the work that I do, and also, you know, Revolutionary Fitness. People might not know how much of an influence John and Monkey Bar Gym has on ourself, but you can just come to one of our classes and feel a little bit of Monkey Bar Gym influence all over the place. So, you know, we want to thank you for everything you've done, and, you know, we want to build and continue to build that relationship between, you know, Revolutionary Fitness and Monkey Bar Gym. So thanks for taking the time out today, man, to get on here.
Well, thank you. And Sean, I want to thank you for what you're doing. You're in a big city there. You're trying to do something. You're not trying. You are doing something that is positive for people on the planet. So if I can help you in any way to do that, I love to do that and appreciate the opportunity. And I just want to give you a big high five for doing it, because that's awesome. I commend you for it.
Thank you, brother. All right, man. So yeah, we'll speak to you soon, man.
Okay, Sean. You take care.
All right. You take care of yourself too, bro.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Looking for a better way to get up out of bed instead of getting on the internet and checking a new hit. Me get up, first shot, come strut walking, a little bit of humble, a little bit of cautious, somewhere between like Rocky and Cosby's for the game. Nope, y'all can't copy yet. Glad moonwalking, and this here is our party. My posse's been on Broadway and we did it all way. Chrome music, I shed my skin and put my bones into everything I record to it, and yeah, I'm on. Let that stage light go and shine on down. Got that body. Rob Barker, suit game, and Plinko in my style. Money, stay on my craft and stick around for those pounds. But I do that to pass the torch and put on for my town. Trust me, on my INDEPENDENT shit hustling. Chasing dreams since I was 14 with the four-track bussing. Halfway across that city with the back.